I've been on an adventure. I've seen creatures I'd never imagined, and landscapes out of a dream. At other times it was harsh, but in the darkness of the storm, I encountered a little ship. It gave me a push and said, "Don't you see that light?" In time, historians will say that it was just a legend, but for me, that was the truth. Hello and welcome to One Piece 101, the series that breaks down everyone and everything in the One Piece world. Today, we will be examining the original One Piece princess, Nefertari Vivi. Vivi is a kind, brave, and generally selfless girl encountered by the Straw Hats almost immediately after they entered the Grand Line. Although we weren't to know about this kindness, bravery, and selflessness at first, because she was posing as an agent of Baroque Works, an underground organization led by then Warlord of the Sea, Sir Crocodile. She and her partner Mr. Nine served primarily as comic relief villains during the Reverse Mountain and Whiskey Peak arcs. During the latter arc, Vivi, known by her alias Miss Wednesday, and several other agents were charged with killing Luffy and collecting his 30 million Berry bounty. However, this proved to be the incorrect course of action, as Vivi, Mr. Nine, Miss Monday, and Igaram were fairly easily dealt with by a certain Roanoa Zoro. That's alright though, because Vivi was forced to reveal her identity and betray Baroque Works when Mr. Five and Miss Valentine arrived on the island and announced that there was a spy within their midst. Because in reality, Vivi was a princess of the Alabastic Kingdom, currently under the rule of her father, Nefertari Cobra. As a child, Vivi was highly involved in royal activities and was even present at a previous reverie, an event that gathers all kings under the affiliation of the world government for a 7-day conference. But she also did regular kid things like starting a secret group known as the Sunasuna Clan with her childhood friend Koza. Although Vivi being a princess did predictably cause some unfortunate situations, one of which was her being kidnapped, and although the Sunasuna Clan stood tall to defend her, Vivi had to be rescued by her father Cobra, as well as Igaram, Pell, and Chaka. The latter three characters were often charged as retainers of Vivi, keeping a close eye on her at all times. Well, except for this one time where she got kidnapped. But hey, everyone makes mistakes. Vivi would grow quite close to all three of them, particularly Pell, who, having eaten a falcon-type Zoan devil fruit, would often take Vivi flying on his back, even though the king had forbidden it. In regards to her father, Cobra shows great love for his daughter and an even greater faith in her abilities and pure determination, believing wholeheartedly that she will be a wonderful figurehead of Alabasta when the time comes. Finally, it's worth noting that Vivi is also very close to her pet duck, Karu, whom she has had since childhood. The bond these two share is stronger than Vivi holds with any other character, and she is able to put her complete trust into this adorably built creature, even if he does more often than not misunderstand simple instructions. Many years later, Sir Crocodile arrived at the country of Alabasta, causing a string of strange events involving the country plunging into drought. Well, all of the country except for the capital city of Alabasta, known as Alubarna. Crocodile then proceeded to frame the king via planting a substance known as dance powder within the royal palace. And just very briefly on dance powder, this substance is able to create artificial rain. However, in the process, it uses up natural rainfall that would occur in other neighboring areas. So the discovery of dance powder within the palace prompted much of the population to believe that King Cobra was hoarding all of the rain for himself, and gradually, this formed into a full-scale rebellion against the king and his forces. Suspecting Crocodile, Vivi and Igaram then infiltrated Baroque Works in an effort to expose Crocodile and learn his ultimate plan for the country. During her time in the organization, Vivi formed quite strong bonds with her partner agents Mr. Nine as well as Miss Monday. In fact, during Whiskey Peak, when Vivi's status as a spy was revealed, both of these agents stood by her regardless and were prepared to risk their lives to ensure Vivi's safety. After defeating Mr. Five and Miss Valentine, the Straw Hats learnt the truth of the matter and agreed to escort Vivi as well as her pet duck Karu back to Alabasta. And after this moment, Vivi's personality took a complete 180 from comical, sly, and incompetent villain to vulnerable yet extraordinarily determined princess. As she journeyed with the Straw Hats, Vivi also began to show a more light-hearted nature and came to quite genuinely care about her new companions. This was epitomized when Nami fell ill as a result of being bitten by a bug on Little Garden, and Vivi put her mission to save her country on hold so that they could sail to Drum Island and find a doctor for her. However, the crew would eventually land on the island of Alabasta, in the port of Nanohana to be specific, where the crew had a brief encounter with Marine Captain Smoker as well as Luffy's brother Ace. Next, the group would hit the mostly deserted city of Yuba, where Vivi encountered Toto, the father of her childhood friend Koza. And to further complicate matters, Toto informed informed Vivi that Koza was now the leader of the rebellion against her father. After departing Yuba, Vivi and Luffy engaged in a heated argument, with the captain of the Straw Hats suggesting that rather than trying to reach the rebel army, they should be in fact targeting Crocodile, who was the true cause of the horrible events taking place. A lot of punching ensued, but eventually Vivi acquiesced to Luffy's logic, which is not a thing you can say very often, and the group departed to Crocodile's headquarters at Rain Base. And I definitely can't say that this part of the story went in favor of Vivi and the Straw Hats, culminating in almost all of them being captured, but not before Vivi got to smack Sir Crocodile in the face with her peacock slasher. It did absolutely nothing to harm him, but my god, was it satisfying to see. In the end, everybody was saved by Sanji, and the group raced to the capital of Alabana in order to make a last-ditch effort to cease the invasion of the rebel army. In this effort, the Straw Hats distracted the agents of Baroque Works, who were sent to ensure the success of Crocodile's plans, and Vivi was almost successful in coming into contact with Koza. However, due to the interference of another Baroque Works agent in the guise of a soldier, Vivi failed to stop the rebel army, and a battle began throughout the city of Alubarna. But in an effort to save her country, Vivi continued to struggle, managing to make it all the way to the palace, confront Crocodile a second time, and even hunt down a bomb that he had planted in a clock tower, managing to defeat Miss Father's Day and Mr. Seven in the process. Unfortunately, despite making it to the bomb in time, there was no way to prevent it from exploding. However, Pell arrived to the clock tower just in time, and was able to carry the bomb far enough away to prevent Alubarna from being engulfed in the ensuing explosion, thus sacrificing his life for the good of— Actually, he didn't die. I don't know why. It's just how it is. But back to Vivi. Following the explosion, she took this opportunity to implore the citizens of Alabasta to stop fighting. However, they couldn't hear her over all the, fighting. It wouldn't be until Luffy defeated Crocodile and rain fell on the city that Vivi's words were finally heard. Crocodile was revealed to be the true mastermind, and the civil war of Alabasta came to an immediate end. In the coming days, Vivi resumed her role as Princess of Alabasta, although it was not an easy decision. Luffy and the other Straw Hats had invited her to continue traveling with them, but ultimately, Vivi tearfully declined their invitation out of a desire to help her country. The Straw Hats then departed Alabasta, letting Vivi know full well that they will always be Nakama. Vivi then took a back seat in the story, primarily making cameo appearances, generally reacting to new Straw Hat bounties, as well as visiting a hot spring which Genatsu helped build with Koza's uncle. The next time Vivi would be actively seen in the story would be during the Zou arc, as she was preparing to set sail for the Reverie. And here I'll issue a bit of a spoiler warning here for the events of the Reverie, which have not been animated at the time of this recording. If you do not wish to be spoiled on the Reverie arc, then I'd recommend muting your volume until this warning has vanished from the screen. During the Reverie, Vivi encountered Shirahoshi and Rebecca, forming a sort of triumvirate of princesses. But on a more sinister note, a photo of Vivi was seen in the hands of the mysterious figure that is Eam, as the Gorosei were inquiring as to which light needed to be extinguished from history. Some more fun facts about Vivi. Vivi is one of the rare characters outside of the Straw Hats to possess their own personal Jolly Roger. It first appeared in a nightmare sequence where Igram was imagining Vivi running off to become a pirate. Although she only performed it once, Vivi has an attack named Miwaku no Memai Dansu, whereby she performs a hypnotic dance designed to immobilize opponents. Although in the anime they made this attack perfume-based in an effort to somewhat desexualize Vivi. Vivi's surname Nefertari is actually the Egyptian word for most beautiful and was often used to describe Egyptian queens and princesses, and I guess in this case, Vivi's father, Nefertari Cobra. Despite being absent for a large majority of the series, Vivi's popularity remains extraordinarily steady, having secured the number 24 spot in both the 5th and 6th character polls respectively. And it's particularly worth noting that that latest poll was taken prior to the Reverie arc. And finally, a truly useless fact. In the 4Kids dub, Vivi's name was pronounced as Vivi, much like I do. However, in the Funimation dub, her name is pronounced as Vivi, as in V-E-E-V-E. There is no good reason for this that I am aware of. And that pretty much does it for Vivi. If you enjoyed this video, then feel free to like, favorite, or subscribe. And if you are in any way keen on supporting this independent channel, then please do check out my Patreon, Discord server, or Twitter, the links to which are in the handy description below. And finally, please do comment with who, what, or where you'd like to see featured on the next One Piece 101.